this watch I wear quite often. And this one is, well, technically quite interesting. And here you immediately recognize the same coils. And what I love about this movement is the way the second hand moves. It's so elegant and so nice. Many watchmaker friends are quite fond of this tuning fork movement, and I will show you in a moment how it works. There's only one movement even more smoother with the second hand, and that's the Seiko spring drive, which is genius in itself. But I love this tuning fork. I will show you the inside because that is quite interesting. Well, look at this. I think quite a few of you never expected a balance wheel and a balance spring in an electronic watch. And again, a few things we recognize and understand now. Inderdaad, Max, ik zie nu pas je comment. Yeah, sure. Here we see the coil. And very simply said, we can explain it as a magnetic field that we can turn on and off. Wow. And now it just stops. See what's wrong with it. But now it's actually a good thing that it stops, because now we can show you even more detail. Look at this. This coil is like a magnetic switch on and off. And here, I can show you because it stops. There is this piece here is a permanent magnet on a balance wheel. Let's have a cup of coffee. And every time, and here you can see a very small contact. Yeah, you can see it moving. You see it here? There it goes. This contact will automatically switch this coil on and off. So in the exact right time, this piece will be magnetic and pulls the small magnet on the balance wheel. And that's why it keeps running. Well, if there's enough power in the battery, but I quite love that it stops now. So you can see how it's moving. And there's such a small air gap here. And what boggles the mind, you really don't want a permanent magnet near your balance spring. So for me, this electronic movement is all the downsides of electronics, because you introduce a magnetic field very close to your balance spring. And it's the, well, downside of mechanical movement. All the hassle balance spring gives, it can stuck. It's just, you still need your shock resistance. It's just not the combination you would like to have. You still have all the negative sides of the balance wheel. the accuracy comes from the balance spring, and quartz is at least 100 times more accurate than this spring. So introducing this beauty. And this is so much more clever than the electronic watch I just showed you. The Lip Nautic Ski. Two coils, which are the magnetic switches, simply said. And this is a tuning fork, just like the one you use on your piano. And this is the base. And here are two tuning forks. So it's always in resonance, like this. And these coils will keep them in resonance. Very simple. Well, if you use a tuning fork, these will go back and forth. I guess in resonance. If we put a coil there, then we'll be having a movement like that. And it hums, this one, just like a tuning fork on a piano. Ping! Well, that resonance is very audible in movements like this. You don't want to leave this on your nightstand because it will keep you awake. And this is a very simple representation how the oscillator, the things that keeps time, like the pendulum, or a balance wheel, or a quartz element, or in this particular case, a tuning fork. These are two, well, small springs. And with this sawtooth, with 360 teeth, the gear train will be pulled in like this. Does it make sense? These two sides of the tuning fork go this way. So every time the two the small springs will go this way. And just the gear train will move like this. And that's the oscillator. And because the oscillation is so fast, and these teeth are so small, the movement is very, very elegant and nice. And very basically, that's the way a tuning fork runs. So we need the battery for these coils, so the tuning fork will always stay in oscillation. I hope that makes sense. And please let me know if there are any questions in the chat, or everybody just dozed off. Or were you all quite aware of how this tuning fork moves? I just love this design, but it's, as you can see, quite challenging to work on and to design. And oh, Micaiah, it's all news for you. Oh, nice. This is so delicate. And this was just about 1965. Technically perfect, but so boring and shitty and no jewels, and it's just quite horrible. And here you can see the plastic gear train. It's no soul, that's it. Here is the plastic gear train, so you don't need any lubrication, so you don't need jewels. And this is so cost efficient, but without any love for, well, heritage. The amount of play in the pivots is just horrible, and the thing still runs. It's like the cockroach of movements. Whatever happens, it still runs. And so accurate. No lubrication, no jewels, nothing. A huge amount of play, and it works. Engine Uber, no, it's a Bosch. I will show you the watch in a moment. But if you can build we do need that hammer icon, patine. Oh. I so agree. But just imagine if you can make a movement with such an amount of play as visible here. It's just going everywhere. So cheap. And it doesn't need any maintenance. And it's 100 times more accurate than a Rolex. It's genius. And yeah, this is, if you buy this movement in bulk, it would probably will be less than a euro. And if you buy just one, it's just around 3 euros. And still, millions of watches run with these movements, and it is still genius. So, even though there are beautiful, high quality quartz movements, there is still a lot of horrible garbage around, and still you can pay up for 200-250 euros and still get garbage. So if you want to buy a watch, start asking some questions. What is on the inside? What am I buying? And not just, well, it's not too cheap, so it should be quality, because it isn't. And if I buy a car, I want to see the engine. I want to see what it looks like. I want to see if it's in good condition, if it's not a huge amount of oil in there. And I still think, when if you buy a watch from a jeweler's, why not ask them to open the watch so you can see the mechanics? And if it's a quality watch, like with the ETA movements I just showed you with the blue E-block, there is nothing to be ashamed about. And even a jeweler can open it and show you the beauty of the movement inside, or stuff like this. And this is just one example I got lying here. And if you like the watch, and there's nothing wrong with it, if it's just what you want, because you're buying an accurate timepiece, it runs for at least a year, there's nothing wrong with it. But it's like a lawnmower engine in a Ferrari chassis. It's just not in. You can't compare the inside with the outside. So if you pay a lot of money for a watch you really like, start asking some questions about the inside of the watch, and any jeweler will be able to tell you what's on the inside and be happy to show you